human life. The first one they have recognized as the discovery of wheel. Now without wheel, nothing happens. Any factory, computer, whatever. Wheel is one of the first and most important discovery in human history. But we don't know who discovered wheel. Even our earliest civilizations like Babylonia, Sumeria, Assyria, Egyptian, Indus Valley, there were references about wheel, which means at least 2,000, 3,000 years before these civilizations, man should have found out the wheel. The second discovery was after nearly 5,000, assuming that wheel was discovered about 2,000 years before Babylonia. The second discovery, the important discovery, was harnessing steam power. So until 17th century, man was using his own muscle power or using the animal power, the tail of the animal power. But it was only in the 17th century he started harnessing steam power, and it was James Watt who gave shape to this. It changed history. The Industrial Revolution, urbanization, capitalization, colonization, many developments flowed. But the major difference between those discoveries and the discoveries taking place now, in those days, there's a vast time gap, 1,000 years, 1,500 years after one discovery, and subsequently, 100 years. But what happened in the last 30 years? The computer, internet in 1989, cell phone. These three discoveries have made our old systems completely upside down. It has got so much of impact on our human history. Within a short span of 30 years, it means we are in a critical phase of change. The change is profound. It is significant. It is sweeping. It is not just significant, it is sweeping. It affects every aspect of our life. And you know what is driving these discoveries? It is not agriculture. It is not management. What is driving these discoveries are science and technology. It is you. It is your subject that is creating such a lasting impact on human lives. It is science and technology that is driving these changes. They are not just driving, they are also defining. Driving is giving a direction. Defining is giving a shape to it. It drives and it gives a shape to the discoveries. It is science and technology. As engineers, you have, and your predecessors have played a significant role in these changes. It means we are in a critical phase of human life. There are changes. These changes are sweeping. And it is science and technology that is driving this sweep. It is defining. How is it relevant to us? All those who absorb this, who adapt this, they can sail along with this. Those who do not absorb, those who do not align themselves with the changes will have to go by wayside. They will be simply overtaken. The change is profound, and if you are willing to absorb this change, adapt to this change, opportunities are again equally profound. If you are willing to adapt, learn, understand from the changes, opportunity for every one of you is equally profound. And if you don't adapt, then we will have no say. We will be simply overtaken by these changes. Now, having said this, what are the emerging trends? Now, once we say change is sweeping, it is frequent, it is significant, where do we go? What will happen in the next 5 years? Now, I'm not going to talk about what will happen after 20 years, after 30 years, no. Just 5 years, 5 to 6 years. By 2020, how will our world will be? I can give you just 4 or 5 instances. Now, you all know how computer prices slashed down. You all know about the CDs which were sold for 500, 600 rupees about 4 or 5 years before are now sold for, what is the cost of a CD now? 5 rupees? 10 rupees? Which was sold for 500, 600 about 5 years before. The pen drive, initially we used to talk about kilobytes and then we switched over to megabytes. That's all TB. It's all TB now. Once if you are going to get the third generation pen drive with solid state mechanism, it will be much faster than the present hard disks. There's a law called Moore's law. Moore's law says the power of the computer and its speed. Moore's law says the power of the computer and its speed will double once in 18 months. In every 1.5 year, the power of the computer and its speed, its internal memory, its computing speed will increase by 1.5 times. Every 18 months. Assuming that at the same speed, the computing speed, both hardware and software progress, what has happened to the CD will happen to computer chips. Chips will cost around 50 rupees, 40 rupees, another 4 or 5 years time. If the chips are going to cost just 4 or 5 rupees, with internet capability, storage and data recovery, what will happen? I wear a specs. There will be a chip with the specs, with internet capability. See, many times we have come across situations where we meet somebody and we don't immediately recall the name. We don't immediately recall the name and context in which we met them. But this computer chip will tell you. We don't know whether it is Ramasamy or Kupisamy. But the computer, the chip, and the specs will tell you, you fool, he's Ramasamy. You met him last week, or last year, or 5 years before. This is the context where you met him. Yeah, specs with the chip and internet facility is going to come. It is going to come in just 5 years' time. All right, I am wearing specs. What happens if somebody don't wear a specs? You know what will happen? You have contact lenses. There will be a chip in the contact lens. Contact lens with the chip with internet facility. The student should immediately jump into it. Even now, what I've been hearing from our professors, sir, we don't let the cell phones into examination hall at all. The smartphones, cell phones and smartphones make students' exam preparation and writing of exams is very easy. Because you memorize, in the cell phone you have all formulas and data. If cell phones are allowed inside the class, what will happen in your examination hall? What will happen? All will pass, even for a cell phone. Suppose you have a chip with internet facility in the contact lens, and with that contact lens, if you enter into the classroom, the entire book, the entire Google is there in your eye, and no professor can detect it also. What will happen? This is what going to happen. In another 5 years' time, this will happen. Therefore, we need to devise some other way of evaluation. This routine evaluation of conducting tests, giving a question paper, it won't work. Now, why I'm repeating, the change is sweeping. Unless we have a vision, unless we foresee, unless we adapt. See what Charles Darwin said? Charles Darwin, in his theory of evolution, but very, very often quoted statement of Darwin was, survival of the fittest. But what he actually meant was, any species that does not adapt to the change will extinct. A species that will survive only if it adapts to the change. That is what going to happen. The 5 years time is going to happen. Now what will happen again? There are cars. Now cars will be driven by these chips, electronic chips. Electronic chip and a sensor, you don't need a driver. The cars will go on their own. They can locate all obstructions, navigate themselves without the help of a driver. Which means there won't be traffic signals, there won't be traffic jams, there won't be traffic accidents. This is what going to happen. Now, another important development will be these chips, nanotechnology, biotechnology. They are going to make entire health sector upside down. Even now we have come across strips. Suppose I am a blood pressure patient. If I wear a strip, that will indicate minute to minute what is my pressure. If I am a diabetes patient, if I wear a strip, that will indicate what is my sugar level, glucose level. It's a real time, on time, it can be fed into the computer. Computer will monitor, even now. But what will happen in future? You see, for women, two deadliest diseases are breast cancer and cervical cancer. They're the deadliest diseases. And death will be painful, the most painful death. If it is detected in advance, if you are able to detect both breast cancer and cervical cancer in advance, cure is 100%. 100% you can cure. These breast cancer cells at the advanced stage will multiply in terms of 10 billion cells. 10 billion cells will multiply. But 15 years before, in the protein we excrete, there will be hundreds of cells. What will happen? There will be chips in our toilets, in our flush outs. When human fluids and solids are excreted, these chips will diagnose the protein and they will say whether it is infested with cancer cells. The chips will indicate to you, please mind that there are 100 cells, 100 breast cancer cells in your protein excreted. Be careful. After 15 years time, you are likely to get cancer. This is what going to happen. And using biotechnology and nanotechnology, they have started growing organs. The first bladder, using biotechnology and nanotechnology with electronic chips, the first bladder has already been grown. In another 5 years time, they are going to grow liver. I think all liquor addicts should be very extremely happy, because even if your liver gets spoiled, you need not worry. You'll get the liver, new liver, it's going to come. So this is going to be the trend. And there are many more. We can keep on talking, but let me wind up now and come back to you Dev tomorrow with some more ideas. But all that I say, the technology is changing, the change is sweep, it is significant, and it's all done by you engineers. If you are able to absorb this, adopt this, there are opportunities profound, galore. And if you don't adopt, if you don't foresee, you will be left by wayside, you will be simply overtaken. Therefore, kindly keep yourselves updated, abreast of the latest developments, and make best use of the opportunity given to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Tamil Nadu State Council for Higher Education. She is an erudite scholar with very high academic acumen. Dr. Cynthia is one among the visionary leaders who always envisages that the higher education should always be innovative. She has been consistent in infusing the idea of creative education throughout Tamil Nadu, and as a result of her contribution to the field of higher education is prodigious. This luminary invariably exhorts the educational institutions to provide good professionals who also turn out to be responsible and law-abiding citizens. Dr. Cynthia has been instrumental in motivating the first generation learners, especially in the rural area. Her gentle approach and affable nature towards the needy has taken her to greater heights. Dr. Cynthia's innovative insight has enabled her to design courses such as parent counseling, education software development, and many more. Dr. Cynthia Pandian's indomitable experience in education has also made her become the Vice Chancellor of Manonmaniam Sundaranar University, Tirunelveli. Her expertise in the educational arena was observed by the Association of Commonwealth Universities, London, and she was selected in 2006 as one of the 20 Vice Chancellors of Commonwealth countries for a week-long international program on managing change in global knowledge economy. Professor Dr. Cynthia Pandian is a proud recipient of many honors. To name a few, Colonel Commandant of NCC 2007, Best Woman Academic Administrator 2006, Best Woman Vice Chancellor 2006, Diamond Star Award 2007, Woman of Millennium 2007, and Woman of Excellence 2010. Dr. Cynthia won the International Fellowship for 2003-2004 to conduct a study on reaching the disadvantaged with quality education in the United States. May we now request Dr. Cynthia Pandian to deliver the presidential address?
Most respected scientist, Dr. Y.S. Rajan, the chairman of the Banari Aman Institute of Technology, Dr. S.V. Balasubramanian, Dr. M.P. Vijayakumar, the honorary advisor of this institute, Dr. A.M. Nadrajan, the chief executive, Dr. X.K. Sundararaman, director, Dr. Shanmugam, the principal of the institute, Mr. B. Saravanan, Mr. Srijit, Mr. Sundararaman, Ms. Sharmila, and Ms. Sabrinath, distinguished educationists, professors, and dear participants from different parts of our country. I deem it a great privilege and opportunity to stand before you and preside over this mega event of this Banari Aman Institute of Technology. Actually, last year in March beginning, when I took over as the vice chairperson of the State Council for Higher Education, the first invitation was from Banari Institute. It was on the second day itself. The institute people at the Madras branch, they met me, they wished me with a calendar and a diary, and they invited me for the convocation, I remember. But unfortunately, at that time, I could not accept the invitation because it was just 2 days that I had taken. So I said, someday or other, I would definitely visit the institution, and today I have the opportunity to be here. So I thank you. I thank the chairman for giving me this opportunity. And it was too long an introduction about me, which we don't expect normally in functions like this. Anyhow, I thank the one who read about me also. In the morning, when I was having discussion with the chairman, Mr. Rajan, and all others, I was fascinated by the way this institution is functioning. Of course, I'm fascinated by the huge campus here, the excellent infrastructure facilities. Should I call them world-class infrastructure facilities? It won't be wrong if I do it. The illustrious and very impressive faculty members whom I met this morning, and of course very smart students seated here. I am impressed by the climate that has been created in this institution by the chairman. By climate, I mean the kind of interactions, the kind of comfort that you teachers as well as the students have here. And I can see how, what best the chairman is doing to make the students and the faculty happy, and also to boost the morale of both students as well as the faculty. So I congratulate him, and I have great appreciation for his enthusiasm. In the welcome address also, we listened to all the credentials of this college. I'm not surprised at these credentials, because this college is being steered by two eminent industrialists, educationists, of what should we say, administrators, Dr. Rajan and Dr. Vijay Kumar. So I could listen to a list of activities that are going on in this institution. I was really admiring the institution and the chairman, and of course all those who have been supporting him. At one point in time, I asked the chairman why you should not make all your achievements visible to other institutions in Tamil Nadu. Everybody should know what is happening in this institute. And I'm sure the others also should follow suit of this institute. So I feel very, very honored to preside over this mega event of Bandari Amman Institute. Like how Dr. Vijay Kumar said, I'm also taken or admire the word futura, the futura. The title futura is very encouraging, because the vision of higher education for future is focused on empowering the young people like you with all forms of education and skill building, with the accelerating development of technologies. Higher education in the next one or two decades, we hope to be quite different from what it is today in terms of access, interactions, curriculum and instructions, as well as in the ranking of institutions. And in this context, I would like to congratulate the Bandari Amman Institute, which has been ranked third among the self-financing technical institutions in India. It is very heartening to note that India has the third largest education system in the world, with 600 universities and 30,000 colleges. We also have the third largest pool of science and technology graduates in the world. 62% of graduates are from art subjects, and the balance 38 are from science, IT, medicine, engineering, management, and other special subjects. Yet, most of the so-called graduates are not employable, including the graduates from technical education. Of those employed, 1% is with government, 2% is with private institutions or private sectors, and the rest of the 97% is with the unorganized sector. This is because the present system of higher education does not prepare the youth with skill sets for generating knowledge and innovating technology that is required to run a nation. It does not provide scope for either employment or enterprise. But in this context, again, I would like to congratulate the chairman and this institute, because I was told that most of the people here who come out of this institution get jobs, and sometimes you get employed in their own industries. In the recent National Roundtable on Government Industry Partnership, organized by the Ministry of Human Resource Development, it was expressed that India continues to be plagued with problems of inept handling of technology, be it water resources, poor quality of drinking water, inadequate utilization of natural resources, bad roads, power shortages, wastage and theft in distribution systems, and overall lack of maintenance of national assets. It was also stressed that higher education, particularly technical education, needs to work aggressively and extensively on finding answers to our problems, whether they are in power sector, infrastructure, mining, tourism, entertainment, telecom, agriculture, or urban development. Higher education, particularly technical education, should facilitate our system to put higher order thinking skills, analytical skills, cross-sector multidisciplinary skills into finding innovative solutions. At present, we do have a number of institutions, both for general education and for technical education. But most of these institutions are established to provide the traditional, the conventional degrees. Research becomes only a small part of this education system. Even some of the industries which run, which are established institutions, they give the traditional degrees, the conventional degrees, but research to some extent is neglected. I'm not talking about Banaria Men Institute, because the very fact of coming here today, all of you have gathered here only to boost your research skills. But in general, the research aspect, the innovative aspect is very poor in our country. Hence, the Ministry of HRD is contemplating on setting up the theme-based research and innovation institutions. The major aim is to bring the government, the academia, and the industry in closer partnership for innovation and research. These institutions are different from regular degree-providing institutions and would admit trained people from across disciplines to do research and innovation, leading to the award of a PhD on specific problems such as how to provide clean and safe drinking water in remote areas, how to provide electricity in villages which are still not powered, how to build maintenance-free roads, how to stop transfer and distribution losses in electric transmission, how to decongest airports, how to address malnutrition in children effectively, how to bring down the cost of healthcare and maintaining its quality, and the like. The technology that drives these areas is of importance to students gathered here. You take your ideas from these problems that have been posed by the Government of India. Institutions like Banaria Men Institute of Technology should take advantage of such proposals and come forward to establish institutions of innovations and research, leading to solutions to problems of our nation. What we lack in our present system of education is the spirit of innovation. Our focus is more on providing knowledge than imparting skills. While 75% to 85% of youth of the developed and the developing countries world over learn a skill or a trade between the age of 14 to 35, in India it is only hardly 2%. Therefore, we need skill set education and enterprise skill education, which would cover all types of business, including industries. It is here that entrepreneurship is born. Entrepreneurship could be a successful strategy for the growth and development of a nation's economy. We need to stimulate the entrepreneurship mindset of young people, encourage innovative startups, foster a culture that facilitates entrepreneurship and the growth of small and medium enterprise. At the higher education level, entrepreneurship should be considered as a key competence for all young people to be more creative and self-confident in whatever they undertake. Symposiums and contests such as this help to enrich and share knowledge among students and faculty. Industries expect creativity and innovation, the ability to develop products and systems to enhance productivity, quality, and also managerial ability. Who would not want to know which technologies will be in play towards the end of this decade? With today's speed of innovation and introduction of new technologies world over, anticipating future is no easy task. Whatever may be the future, your technology should be usable and simple. This is the natural path it will take. From the development aspect, industries need usable devices. From the consumer's aspect, the users living in this digital age need simple devices. But there is also the third element, and that is the emotion, a device that delights the users. So the success of any technology is in incorporating all these three aspects. It is said that conventional education uses mostly memory, visual, and speech areas of the brain, which is only 5% of the human brain. But creativity and innovation use more than 90% of the brain. I'm sure all participants who have come for the contest today, in presenting your project designs, you have all used more than 90% of your brain. Contests and symposiums like this have a lot of significance, especially in the new world of learning, in which students are connected through technology, internet, and with different learning styles. In organizing such a symposium and contest, the management and the faculty of Pannaryamman Institute have departed from the traditional methodology to dynamic roles of learning for creating an innovative society for knowledge economy through young people like you. I congratulate them and also wish the symposium and the contest a great success. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. We now request